All right, ladies and gentlemen, I'm the sound tracker, and I've got what is, in my opinion, an interesting one today. It's Crosley. I know. Crosley is pretty much one of the heavily maligned record player manufacturers today, and for good reason. They're pretty, really, really cheaply built, and they just kind of walk the line just above not usable. And I say that on purpose because my first record player, well, I guess not my first, my second record player was a Crosley. And that, believe it or not, was an upgrade to what I had previously. I had a record player at one point made by Fisher, and it was one of those kind of big units that had, you know, a kind of proprietary plug-in speaker system to it. And my neighbors had given it to me because when I was a kid, I was starting to get interested in records, and nobody had them. They happened to have a Fisher, and they gifted it to me. But the needle was so worn that it actually started jumping on records that I was trying to play. And I didn't want to go to any effect to damage them, so I wound up buying a brand new one, which was a Crosley at the time. So I want to do a couple of things in this video, because my coworker passed this lovely little beast on to me. And he's asked that I take a look at the speed adjustment to it, because apparently it's playing a little bit too fast. And I'm curious, A, what that's going to sound like, and B, if we can get it fixed at all. Because I don't have the same experience that most people seem to with Crosley. It was at least okay for me. And I'm going to, I guess, take a look at this, see if I can fix it, and well, we'll go from there.
Alright, so here's the unit itself. It's kind of interestingly designed. I mean, there were a lot of portable suitcase-type record players from past years. I mean, this thing has the speakers in the front, kind of nice clip design here. And on the back, it's got an auxiliary in, line out for through RCA, and DC in over here for the power. And, I mean, that's just kind of what I'd expect from this unit. Let's take a look inside here. Yeah, it's about what I expect from Crosley. Everything's incredibly budget. But let me see, we've got power here. Yeah, power and volume. Just the tone arm here, and that's pretty well weighted, I guess. The speed selector down here, 33, 45, and 78 RPM. For some reason, an auto stop switch, and that's kind of an interesting one, I gotta say. As well as an arm rise over here, which I guess if you need to pause the record at any point, that's not bad. What the hell? Let me do that one more time. Okay, up, and... oh, that's kind of irritating. Wow. So, let me show you that in a little more detail. So the cueing lever over here raises the tone arm up and pushes it a little bit to the side, so when it comes back down, it's not in the same place that it was. So, I mean, in general, just by how a record operates, I wouldn't expect it to be in the same place, but I would expect it to be a little bit more finely tuned than that, because this is well far away from what it started as. I wonder if I can get it to... yep, I can totally get it to bounce all the way across. Heh. Neat. Anyhow, so, I mean, I'm not particularly fond of Crosley as a brand. It was one of my earliest experiences with a record player, but it's definitely no longer my first choice of a record player because, I mean, just of how everything's built in the first case, it's very, very cheap, and you know that just from looking at it. It's only built to play records, and it just does that. It's not exactly a stellar unit, and frankly, even some other cheap models are kind of better than this. But honestly, that's not what my coworker needs, and that's why he has this. He just wants something that'll play records from time to time, and not a lot. He's not like an avid collector. He's just got some records laying around the house. He wants to play them, and this is the unit he got, and it's kind of broken. So let's take a look at that and see what happens, because if I get it started... he said that the issue that he was having was that whatever record he was playing sounded like it was auditioning for the Chipmunks. So, let's see how it sounds, because it does, it has built-in amplified speakers, and let's see what happens. Here's that record. If you've been watching this channel for any length of time, you know I'm a fan of Rush. I am absolutely going to be using a copy of Moving Pictures on this record player for two reasons. One, because as you can tell from all this crap here, this was actually my first copy. And this being my first copy also means that this is the one that I played damn near religiously on a Crosley. So, whatever kind of sort of Crosley damage could come from, say, the needle pressing down too hard on the record, is definitely present on this copy. Now, other than that, Moving Pictures is an album that I have played over and over again so many times and still get so much enjoyment out of that I just like hearing it. And of any of the albums that I have, if there's anything wrong with the timing, I'm gonna know it from this album because it's the one that I listen to the most often. So, let's get the boys on. Okay, so auto stop. That's interesting. So auto stop when it's in the off position just lets the player run. Auto stop when it's in the on position lets it just stay there. So if I do this, okay. All right then. Also, why the hell is it? What is that scraping? Ah, crap. Okay, so the back of this was scraping against this. Give me 2 minutes to figure out how to do this better. Alright, so I pulled the unit forward a little bit, and one of the delightfully crappy things about this is that if this is any length of a degree up, it will immediately rub against the edge of a record if you're playing a 33. So, as far down as you can get this is usually the best, and if yep, so there's like a millimeter of distance. So if you have a record that's warped, it's gonna rub against this. If you have a record that is being played like this, it's also, yeah, it's pressing against it now. So great, I can't wait to see what happened to the camera eye on that one. But let's see how this sounds. So yeah, we're on 33, and let's go. I admit, I kind of like the key change on that, but yeah. All right, I'm sort of curious what the other songs are gonna sound like that. Hang on. Stop just stops the record, no return, but I mean, yeah, I don't like that, but then again, it's not made to be anything stellar, and it just starts right back up if you lift it over that, cool. But, yeah, I mean, so these are not built to be anything stellar, they're just built to do the basic function of playing a record as mediocre as possible. And, yeah, that, boy, is that a great contender for getting on this album. That, however, is just in 33, though, and I'm actually kind of curious if it's going to sound any different in 45 and especially in 78. So, let's see what happens with that. Alright, so 45 RPM, we've got the Monkees, I'm a Believer. This is one of my favorites of the classic songs, really, so. Let's see, 45. That's looking fast. Okay. So 33 and 45 are pretty much borked. Let's see what Bing Crosby's I Love You can bring forth from 78. Because I am really curious as to how this is going to handle that. So, let's find out. It's already not promising. Interesting thing there, too, because what I'm noticing about that is 33 and 45 didn't exactly sound spectacular, but I wonder what kind of needle this is using, because that sounds like it's actually geared towards playing 78s. That sounded decent. You know, I'll tell you what, once I get the speed adjustment going, I'm going to get a direct line out of this and see what everything sounds like by the comparison of it. Because that actually sounded okay. Which is fascinating, given that I don't think very many people are buying these, especially not to play these.
Okay, so we've determined that the speed on the turntable is maladjusted, and that's not great. So, there's a couple of different ways to go about fixing this, but the first way will involve this device here. So this is called a stroboscope, and what this does is essentially, while the turntable is spinning, you can get a reading on how fast it's traveling just by shining a particular type of light on it. And while that's great, I don't think everyone who owns a turntable has one of these. So the second method is the one that I'm going to be using today, and that's just going to be using a regular old 33, 45, or 78. And figuring out how exactly fast it's going to be traveling just by listening to the music.
Alright, so in any case, in every single one of these speeds, it's not playing appropriately. So let's get it open and find out what to adjust and where. The four screws out of the way. Let's put the clip back on and see what lies underneath. This thing is actually fascinatingly simple to a degree that I wasn't expecting. Yeah, this is just an incredibly simple mechanism. I mean, we've got just kind of like a regular sort of very, very basic array of capacitors and resistors, the volume knob here, the different speed selectors over here, the power for the auto stop there. And what's extra fascinating here is that this motor has two speed holes. And so I believe, yeah, so L and H, and I'm curious if that's low and high speed. Because if 78 requires more power, it's probably going to be that one, and low would be 33 and 45. Which, let me see, so we've got brown wire coming off here, into that. Ah! Okay, so we've also got a potentiometer right here. I'm gonna try adjusting that first and see if I can accomplish anything with it. It looks like, yeah, if I just slide a flathead screwdriver into there, I think I can hopefully adjust the speed of all three, especially because one of the wires coming off of the speed selector here heads over to this array, and while I do not actually have a schematic for this, and frankly I'm still just learning about electronics, it seems reasonable to me that they would put a speed potentiometer here, but if not, I can always adjust the speed inside of these things here, because I have a cassette mechanism that runs in the same kind of fashion. My Nakamichi deck has a motor that has a variable speed, so, yeah, let's get turning some knobs. Okay, so if all three speeds are acting up, I'm hopeful that this is just misadjusted somehow. Let's find out. Let's see what a clockwise turn does for that. Just get this kind of level here. Sorta. And okay, so auto stop off, and let's see here. That's running slower.
Okay, let's grab that record again.
Let's see how that voice is doing. Is it... Okay, show me the magic. Needs a little more. Okay, that's as far as that's going. Okay, so I have it turned all the way to the right. Let's see what happens. That's still wrong. That's still very, very wrong indeed. Alright, so. That was all the way to one side, and it seems as though that didn't actually adjust anything. Unless it's meant for one specific speed. Let's see if... So, since that actually didn't do much in terms of changing the speed, let's just set that back where it was. Actually, I wonder what will happen if I turn it all the way to the other side. Let's try that first. That looked faster. Yep. Okay, still fast. So, let's see. What can I adjust on the motor to make the motor itself slower? Because there are, in fact, two potentiometers inside of there. So, let me just get that back where it was, and I can work from there. Okay, so on the motor itself, there are two access ports. There's stamped into both of them. One is labeled L, the other one is labeled H. And I have a feeling that that's for low and high speed. So, let's get our screwdriver in here. It takes, to adjust these kind of speed ports, it takes a small flathead like this one. So, there's an X cut into the foam. Let me see inside of this. Yep, there it is. Okay, so... Feel it sink in. Let's try a slight turn that way. That's on the L, and let's see what happens when I turn it back on now. Are we slower? We are comically slower. Alright. Okay, so it's good to know that I found the particular port that sets the speed for 33. Let me see if that also adjusts it for 45 and 78, though, because if that's true, it will also be... That one's still way too high. Okay. So I'm going to go ahead and say that the H would adjust 78, then, because if 33 and 45 are both running off the lower speed... That's entirely plausible in my opinion. So this is essentially just going to be kind of the tedious grunt work of going back and forth and readjusting and maladjusting and up until you get it right. So I will be back once I get the lower speed all set, and then I'll take a look at the higher speed. Perfect. All right. The speed sounds great to my ears. And the reason that I'm doing it this way, actually, is because there's a tool that you can buy called a stroboscope. And a stroboscope will show you in a precise detail how fast the record player is actually turning. And I wanted to do it this way also to show that you don't actually need special tools to do it. Because if you have a record that you know like the back of your hand, and that you can instantly pick up where the notes are supposed to be, then great, use that record and you can have an easier time adjusting the speed. Now, let's see if that also affected 45, and see what happens with the monkeys. Let's see how this does. A little off, actually. Let me just double check with 33 and see that that didn't actually screw something up in the process. Alright, so 33 still sounds appropriate. 45 does not, and that is making me question a couple of things. Because now I want to know, what's the purpose of that potentiometer on the board? Maybe it's specifically for 78, and that then would mean that this other side, if low here is specifically for 33, then maybe it's supposed to go 33, 45, 78. So let's adjust high and see what that does to 45. If anything at all. Okay, so I just high down, and let's see what happens. Still in 45. Okay, back on. Now, let's. Our adapter. Well, that's definitely slower. all right. I think I'm onto something with this then. So if that's the case, it appears that low is 33, high is 45, and I want to see if this will then. Let's see what happens when I keep doing some adjustments, because if that's adjusting 45, I don't know if it will affect 78 yet, but if it does, great. If not, I'll try that potentiometer again, because I didn't actually do much with that. So, let's see here. Because that's... so far, we're on the right track as far as speed adjustment goes. Sounded good to me, and I mean, frankly, that's to my memory what the song sounds like. So I definitely think it'd be a good idea to run a comparison of these things back to back from say a digital copy. But so we've got 33 and 45 just from the holes on the back of the motor, and that's all set. So I also want to know then, what's up with 78, and how is that gonna do? Whew! Boy, is that fast! Okay, Bing, where are ya? Because I know you're crooning tones anywhere, so.
I love you. I'm the April breeze.
that's way too fast. Okay, so that's very, very definitely not what his voice sounds like. So, one more trip underneath this. And it seems to me that if these two adjust 33 and 45, let's try this out for 78. Let me turn this all the way to the right and see what happens. I cannot believe I forgot to lock the tone arm. I don't think my coworker is going to kill me if I damage it, but I don't think he'll be too happy either. So, when you see this, sorry. All right, let's see what happens with 78. Oh, that's definitely slower. That's too slow. Okay, so I'm glad we're onto something with that then too, because if we've got that down, and I'm glad that they included a different potentiometer for adjusting 78, because that's just good planning. So let me get that a little higher up. Actually, as long as I've done that, let me try and get that. Okay, enough of my rambling. Okay, let's pop that back on here and see what happens. Now that's more like it. Okay, well, I've done a lot of adjusting, and I'm pretty satisfied with the result, but let's take this one step further. So we've got 33, 45, and 78 set up. Let's go one ahead and connect this up to my capture equipment on my computer, and actually see what the difference in sound is like, too. Not just comparing the speed of the records that I've been playing to test this with with a digital counterpart to see if they'll come up to the right speed, but also let's test the sound quality of the Crosley itself, because I'd like to keep an objective mind about that. And I am curious how this is gonna perform with all three different formats and the same needle, because that, from what I understood, different types of records, particularly shellac and vinyl, do not mix. And you would need a different kind of needle, especially because this is also a mono recording. So, I don't know, there's a whole lot more questions raised than answered here. But in any case, I'm going to connect this up to the computer, and we're going to see, A, how it sounds in comparison to a digital file, and B, how it sounds in comparison to another record player. So, let's take a look at that. I'm going to be using a program called Audacity to capture the stereo output of this particular record player. As the signal pumps into it, it's just going to be one song apiece, and we're going to see what happens as far as sound quality goes, and as far as determining whether or not the speed is actually accurate. So we're going to have a good kind of A-B comparison of what's going on. Alrighty. So, I've got everything connected. Everything's as organized as I can make it in this particular instance. So, let's get capturing.
Gets high on you, and the space he invades, he gets by on you. Oh, then I saw her face. Now I'm a believer. Not a trace of doubt in my mind. I'm in love. I'm a believer. I couldn't leave her if I tried.
Oh. I love you. From the April breeze. I love you.
It's very late. I've just finished putting together the whole comparison of everything. And starting with the speed adjustment, I think that went pretty well. It sounds to me like maybe it's just a tiny, tiny bit off, but in any case, when you're casually listening and just throwing on a record, in most cases I don't think people even think about the speed it's playing at unless it's really, really noticeably off. And it sounds fine to me as far as the speed adjustment goes, so I'm satisfied with that. I don't think he's going to be playing 78s much with this, but 33 and 45 I took an extra careful look at, and it sounds appropriate to me, so great. Other than that, as far as whether or not I could actually recommend this as a quality record player, you heard what went on. I mean, I never actually got to do an A-B comparison of my old Crosley, which I still have, by the way. And given that I've just gone through this unit, I mean, there are a lot of questions that I'm raising about my other Crosley as well, because my personal one, I had a lot of years of experience with it. It was my first record player, it was one that I used all the time, and when I finally started upgrading, I just kind of put it away and forgot about it. And I want to go back over that because from the perspective of somebody who had used one for years until I got a proper setup started, at least. Oh my god, did that sound terrible! And that was out of the RCA jacks in the back of the unit! I mean, I knew the speakers sounded really just awful. You heard them earlier in the video! All of that was live feed from the speakers themselves. And if the speakers are that bad and the line out is less than average at best, I mean, I'm just kind of baffled that this thing's on the market at all, because, I mean, it just only plays records, it doesn't do a great job at playing records, and I think I need to do some more talking about Crosley now, because I don't think that's a good product. I don't think that given the general way it sounds and the way that it tends to operate, is terrible, because if I had to open this up and do a speed adjustment that far off in the first case, and the sound is even less than worth it after I do the speed adjustment, what's the point of this thing, other than to just have a cheap, easy way of playing records? I mean, anyway, as I said earlier, there's a lot more questions raised than answered by this thing, and I think it deserves a little bit more talking about. As far as my coworker goes, I don't think he's gonna need anything more than that. He's just looking for something to play records, so that's fine for him, but as far as a starter record player, I don't think you want to start with that. Especially not if it sounds like that and becomes garbage even more over time. So anyway, that's it for now. I'm definitely going to be revisiting Crosley as a whole at some point, because I have a lot of experiences with it, and I'd like to share them with you. Especially in comparison to my other decks over there. Anyhow, well, thanks for watching, and if you like this video, you know what to do.